So welcome back. So continuing from where we left in the last video, so we were discussing about synchronization. So what was synchronization? Synchronization was to avoid the situation where the waveform will walk through the screen. Or why that was coming? Because there should be a frequency relationship between the frequency of the sawtooth waveform that we apply across the horizontal diffraction plate and the signal under investigation that we apply across the vertical deflection plate. What should be the relationship? Either that should the frequency should be multiple, or that should be submultiple. In other cases, the signal you can see that the signal will not be complete, or that will be running along the screen. So such situation can be avoided by synchronization, or by having or establishing a relationship between the signal under investigation and the sawtooth waveform. So there are three modes. One mode we have explained, we have seen last video, that is internally generated. That is when we place the switch in int position, the same signal from that the same signal across the vertical deflection plates are taken from the amplifier, or the signal under investigation is taken from the amplifier. Any signal is taken from the amplifier and that is fed to a Schmitt trigger. What is the peculiarity of a Schmitt trigger? Any be it any signal, a Schmitt trigger will Schmitt trigger, we know it's a regenerative comparator. Its output will vary between two threshold points, that is upper threshold point and the lower threshold point. Ultimately, it is a squaring circuit, irrespective of the waveform. It's a squaring circuit. It's a comparator. Comparator means it will be having a nonlinear relationship. Its output is a nonlinear thing. That is, it varies between LTP and UTP. So it's a squaring circuit. That is why we specifically make it a Schmitt trigger, because it can accept any signal and make it as a square wave. So that such a signal, if we apply to a differentiator, we'll get a train of sharp pulses, and that is what is required. And these train of sharp pulses is in line with the frequency of the signal under investigation, and that is what is applied to the sweep generator, that is across the transistor we have seen. So the transistor will decide when to discharge the capacitor. So depending upon the frequency of that train of pulses, we can choose the frequency of the sawtooth waveform, and that frequency will be in line with the signal under investigation. So that is how the synchronization is obtained. And there is also a provision. Of course, there is also a provision for the user. User also can define his own way. So if that is required, you can connect the switch to external, or the user can give his own external trigger. He can apply trigger by his own. That is what is called the external trigger. So that such a provision is given by the manufacturer. And another provision is that we have the power line. Definitely AC is coming, so you cannot give the 230 volt AC line to line 50 hertz signal to the CRO directly. You have to bring in between a step down transformer so that this voltage should be applied. So 6.3 volt line to line volt with 50 hertz. 50 hertz is the power frequency that can be applied. And that AC, reduced step down AC voltage at this level, can be given to a Schmitt trigger. We know that the input to the Schmitt trigger in that case will be a sine wave. So that sine wave is converted to again a square wave, a square wave. So that square wave is fed to the differentiator circuit, and we'll get a train of pulses. So again, you can see that is. This train of pulses will be having a frequency in line with the power frequency, or you can say that the sweep generator will have a frequency in line with the power frequency. That is also a way of bringing synchronization. Okay, so here we can that is another. So there are three ways: internal, external, that can be defined by the user, or you can take this input to the Schmitt trigger from the power frequency, the power line, or the power line voltage and the frequency. That is the case here, and this is very simple, and that is also usually asked for the examination in part A. Okay, now we move on to the next portion, called another thing called attenuators. I have shown that this block while we discussed about vertical and horizontal amplifiers, that was after the probe, we had a block called attenuators. So in general, what we know, what is attenuators? They are circuits which perform the opposite action to amplifiers. So why do you require attenuators before the vertical amplifier or a horizontal amplifier stage? Anyway, you are amplifying, so why do you want to reduce the amplitude before amplifying the signal? See, we don't know what the quality or the voltage level or the strength of the signal coming. So sometimes the strength of the signal will be very high itself. The strength of the signal itself will be very high. So you cannot give such a signal directly to the vertical amplifier, because if you give such a high strength signal to the vertical amplifier, so that is going to be again amplified. So that what is happening is that you may not see anything on a CRO other than some parallel lines. If you are applying a sinusoidal waveform due to the high voltage strength, so what happens, we may see only some parallel lines. We will be seeing the base part of the sine wave also. So such a situation should be avoided. So when we have such signals coming, we have to reduce the strength, and then you have to apply to the vertical amplifier so that we can actually view the signal perfectly. For signals in millivolt range or few millivolt range, that is not at all a problem. You can set the attenuators in such a way that even attenuation can be avoided. So such a circuit is going to be discussed now. So this is a simple voltage divider circuit. So this is actually the vertical amplifier or a horizontal amplifier that we are discussing, and this is a potential divider. So this is the point where we apply where the signal under investigation is applied, and if this is the portion, if this is the point where we connect the selector switch, this is the point where we have the maximum attenuation, this portion. I'll tell the reason, or the maximum attenuation factor at this point is nothing but 10,000. I'll discuss about this value later, 10,000. And if I connect this point, this one, to B point, then my attenuation will be 1,000. And if I connect to this C point, it is 100. At this point, it is 10. And at this point, there is no attenuation. So what is the meaning when I connect the selector switch to E? Then what I mean is that whatever is the input signal, that will be directly applied. Whatever is this point is will be connected to this point, and this point will be connected to this point. So whatever is the incoming volt, incoming signal, that is directly applied to the amplifier. So what is the quality of such signal? That signal should be of very low amplitude, maybe in few millivolt. Such signals you need not attenuate, you can give directly to the amplifier. For all other signals, you may require some attenuation factors. So how do you decide on the attenuation factors? So what is an attenuation factor? See, it is the VO dash by VI, that is, or VO by VI. What is the output here? So anyway, the selector switches will decide the output. So that VO to VI is equal to R by RT. So what is RT? RT is nothing but the total resistance. This total resistance is RT, that is common. So what is the total resistance? If you count, it is 10 kilo ohm is the total resistance. Okay, so what is R? If I connect the selector switch to A, then my R will be 10. If I connect the selector switch to B, then my R will be 100 ohms. If I connect that to C, then that is 100 plus 900, 1 kilo ohm. So R varies depend upon the selector switches, or the switches where we place the switches. So that is how you calculate the attenuation factors. So what is the, how do you calculate the 10, when I connect the selector switch to A, I told that the attenuation factor is 10,000. How do you get 10,000? That is 10 by 100 kilo will get a factor called 1 by 10,000. Okay, so that means that my attenuation factor is 10,000. Okay, I'm attenuating by a factor 10,000. 1 by 10,000 means we are attenuating by 10,000. Okay, if you multiply by 10,000, I can tell that we are amplifying by 10,000. So likewise, you can calculate the attenuation factors. So this is another block which is present before the vertical amplifier or the horizontal amplifier. Now, next we are moving to a very important portion, that is called how we can measure phase and frequency in a list using a CRO waveform. Okay, so this is another thing. So there is only one thing, that is vertical deflection plate. Of course, we apply the signal under investigation, that is, there is no change in that. But across the horizontal deflection plate, I have two options. We have seen that one option is that it accepts the C generator output, or it accepts the sawtooth waveform. What is the other option? The other option is that you can detach the horizontal deflection plate from the sweep generator, and they can accept another some other signal. Maybe it can be a sine wave. Okay, so So such a difference is there in the horizontal deflection plate. Okay, so this is my definition. That is when it is interesting to consider the characteristics or the patterns that appear on the screen of a CRT when sinusoidal voltages are simultaneously applied to horizontal and vertical plates. So I apply sinusoidal waveform to vertical plates, and if I apply same sinusoidal voltage or some other sinusoidal voltage with some voltage or frequency to the horizontal deflection plate, I'll get a specific or a special pattern, and that is called Lesage's patterns. Of course, many of you may have seen that to obtain the Lesage's patterns, we have to put the CRO in XY mode. That is, X will stands for the horizontal signal we apply to the horizontal deflection plate, and Y stands for the signal we apply across the vertical deflection plate. So both should be sinusoidal waveform. Both can have equal frequencies, equal phase, or equal voltages, or they can differ totally in three variables also. They can vary in voltages, vary in frequency, or vary in phases. All these three cases, we can get certain typical patterns. So seeing that typical patterns, we can easily measure the phase and frequency. So I'll go into the details of that. So first case, hello. So this is the signal that we apply across vertical deflection plate, and this is another signal we apply across the horizontal deflection plate or the X plates. The Y plate is the vertical deflection plate. Suppose to start with, I suppose that they are having the same magnitude, same phase. Why same phase? Zero is this point and zero is this point. How do you find the reference voltage, reference position? Reference position is nothing but the first point. The first point in the first coordinate is the reference position. That is, make it clear, the first point, the first coordinate is called the reference position. Okay, so here it is zero here, here it is zero here. So both are in phase. So how to draw this one? So this is my CRO screen. Zero here, zero here, one here, two here. Every positions are the same. Forget about the numbers for a short while. Extrapolate the broken lines to this point. There is no elongation. You can elongate it here also. Likewise, elongate it here so that the intersection will be this point. Likewise, elongate this line, elongate this line, elongate this line, elongate this line. So you get three points. This is one point, this is another point, and this is another point. Of course, one is coming here, one is also coming here. So this is a common point called one. But 0, 2, 4, both, all the three are zero values, natural zeros, and here also all the three are natural zeros. So this is a common point, 0, 2, or 4, and then 3. Here also 3, here also 3. So you can see that 1, so 3 points. Okay. So you can see that if you join those 3 points, we get a straight line. So what is the conclusion? That is, when I apply two sine waves of equal frequency, equal phase, and equal voltage, what I get is, they are in phase. That is zero phase, same voltage, same frequency, I'll get a straight line. Naturally, one question arises. Suppose I'm having same voltage, same frequency. If I am making this voltage across the Y deflection plate 90 degree opposite, 90 degree out of phase, what is the condition? What will be the case? The case will be 180 degree. Sorry, 180 degree out of phase. This vertical deflection plate voltage is 180 degree out of phase with the horizontal deflection plate voltage. Then you can expect that it is also a straight line, but the straight line will be just the other direction, the other way. That is, if the Y plate voltage is 180 degree out of phase with the X plate voltage, X plate signal, then it is again a straight line, but it will be in the opposite direction. Okay. So I think that is clear. Now, another thing also we'll just see, what happens if my voltage is same, frequency is also same, what is happening if my Y plate voltage is 90 degree out of phase? So I told that this is a zero is the first point in my first quadrant. So here zero is here, this is my zero, so all those things are remaining. So how to draw? Just elongate this line, for the time being don't consider the numbers, just elongate all the lines. So 0 and 4 is here. This line is coming here also, where we have 3 points, 0, 2 and 4. So in any way, we can place 0 and 4 here, because these are the 0s and 4s here, common values, 0 and 4 here. And remaining is 2. We can place 2 here. All other things we'll discuss in the next class. Thank you.